You're listening to Bedroom Beethovens, where notable music makers break down stories accompanied by songs and melodies documenting growth through their 10,000-hour journey. And me? Well, my name is Cello, your host.
I am a bedroom Beethoven.
Hey everybody, welcome to episode 121 of the podcast. My guest this week is...
My name is Will Power. I'm a record producer out of Atlanta, Georgia, and best known for my work with Yelawolf and Wiz Khalifa, Eminem, Big Crit, The Game, and quite a few others.
It's Black Sabbath, how you get mellow? Huh. Well, put your feet on my Harley Davidson pedals and rock and roll, girl.
Like a diamond cuts through a pearl. Yeah. It's the hardest love song in the world.
Hardest love song.
It's a great time to know Will Power as he's at peak inspiration, attracting the right things in his life, and his relationships and experiences will no doubt produce the best work of his life as he gears up for another successful year in the industry. We talk about the 10,000 hours, from the days of pre-trunk music, a southern staple in the mixtape game, Yelawolf, mentorships, bandwidth, which is a record label and production studio based out of Atlanta, which was founded by him, and how it relates to his signees and production catalogs and so much more. But first, appreciate everyone for being here. Just to clarify, this podcast is available wherever it is you get fine podcasts. And for YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, all that good stuff, just search for the name of the show. I'm not on Facebook, though. Not a big fan of that platform, but I've been playing around with the idea for my Patreons to have access to a Discord. You know, what do you guys think? You know, I hear mixed feelings on the topic. Write in and let me know if that's something that you want. But in the meantime, if you want to support the show, patreon.com/bedroombeethovens is the easiest, fastest way to support your boy for a few bucks. You get access to early shows and more. And hit up bedroombeethovens.com for even more stuff like merch and stuff like that. So let's get warmed up for another fresh run of shows through the 120s, kicking things off with the great and powerful Will Power. Enjoy the show. We both run podcasts. You know, I know you're a hit maker. You've worked with amazing people. So when Will Power calls, people answer. But do you know how hard it is for me to get like Drummer Boy to come on? You know, for you, it's probably simple, you know, simple email or phone call. But man, it's tough. Podcasting is a tough game.
It is, man. You know, people, you know, take it for granted. I mean, even for me, man, having some of those relationships, it's still, you'd be surprised how hard it is to get people to take you serious. And you know, even the podcast game is, you know, it's so many people doing podcasts now. There was a time when it was fairly new and, you know, there was some value in getting in shows, but so many people are doing them now. I think that, you know, you have to kind of have a good strategy. But yeah, I've been through that, man. Good luck.
Yeah, just this week alone, Mark Ronson started a podcast, and then Talib Kweli and Mos Def, and I'm like, damn it! Every time a celebrity starts a podcast, there goes a little.
You know what, man? I'm pretty proud of the fact that I got in early on it, man. I think when I first started the Free Game podcast, I you can't quote me on this, but I want to say, man, Illmind might have been the only other person at the time that was really talking to producers and trying to figure out what's going on behind the music. So. Yeah, man, we've been at it a while, bro. So I commend you on it, and I think you're doing a great thing. And don't let the bigger ones or the more popular ones. Don't let that discourage you, because I've also found that the cool shit is in the ones that aren't so popular, because those people want to know the real shit. You know what I mean? The bigger ones get kind of commercial and it just gets weird, man.
Yeah, last year, I'm going to brag a little bit. I got to interview Steve Arrington on the podcast. You're familiar, right? Oh, yeah, you're familiar. Your dad had the record with the little 001 in the top right.
Wow, man. That's crazy. Was it Slave?
Oh, yeah. With the guy holding the world on his back.
Yeah.
Yes. So, I mean, I have no business chopping it up with Steve Arrington, but the podcast allowed me to do that. So
that is crazy, bro. That's crazy that you even knew I had that record. Man.
I know your dad played a big part listening to Minnie Riperton, Al Green. You got exposed to music via his collection, and this wasn't just California. Your dad would bring you to Turtle Wax Records in Columbus, Georgia, and all this. So we owe a great deal to him.
Yeah, man, dude, my dad was military, and so he just, you know, music was his getaway, and just being, you know, his son and around him all the time, we just, man, dude, I took all that in, and it just, you know, helped shape me as a producer and what I love in music. It's like, you know, you'd be surprised at, you know, when you're young, what your ears are doing to you. You know what I mean? And I just appreciate him for caring that much. I mean, he would get records every week, man. And I just remember those times, and I cherish that.
Oh, yeah. You're preaching to the choir, because I grew up in Killeen. So I know all about the military life.
Texas. Come on, man. What's that? Is that Fort Hood?
Right next to Fort Hood. Yeah.
Wow, bro, that's crazy, man.
Yeah, so while you were chopping it up in Leesville, Louisiana, I was growing up in Killeen, not too far away. So,
damn, bro, you really did your homework, man, because no one knows that. I mean, my best friend in life, man, is his family's from Killeen. Mike Jones was his name. Certainly, man, his whole family is from there, and that's really dope. That's how I know so much about it. You know, we used to go visit and shit like that. So, yeah, it's a dope spot, man.
Yeah, so it's crazy, you know, about Killeen. I think our dads were similar, because back then, military guys, they loved their music, they loved their family, and they loved their cars. You know, they'd wash and wax their cars 3 times a week, watch the ball game. It's a wrap.
Woo, that's my dad all the way, man.
That's good. Yeah, so what have you learned doing the podcast? Because for me, by having so many conversations with people in your craft, it has made me a better creative in terms of how I manage my time and observing how people have created success for themselves. So it's had to benefit you. And there's value in those conversations.
Absolutely, man. Like, I think the takeaway is I always learn something that I overlooked or didn't even know existed. You know, it's amazing to hear, you know, a producer tell you their story and then it relate in such a way. Like, you would be surprised at how, you know, you would think like a Dr. Dre has like this magical moment that he like, you know, shows up to the studio on a carpet, you know, riding a carpet with a genie bottle. But the truth is, you know, he's really, you know, everyone just has this real personal connection to the music, and their process is, they're all different, but we're all the same, and, you know, in the same. So it's sort of like, it's just dope to talk to people and find out what they did. When I had a chance to talk to S1, and, you know, he was explaining to me the process and what happened when he did the Power record for Kanye. You know, it's just dope shit, bro. You just start to be like, man, you know, I can really do this. It gives you, you know, it gives me, you know, a lot of courage, you know, in those situations, because, you know, no matter how big a producer you are or how new to this you are, there's always this moment of what's going to really happen here. Is this stuff going to be, you know, is the person I'm working for going to like this shit? Like, what do I do? A lot of those interviews, man, just help free me from any type of fear, because it's like, yo, you could do anything. Everybody gets up and does the same thing. Kanye puts on his pants the same way. Well, maybe Kanye is different, but yeah, man, it's a relationship game, bro.
Yeah, and you met Yelawolf decades ago. It's funny. So he released 2 EPs before people consider EPs to be albums, but that's a separate issue. His album gets shelved. He gets dropped from his label, and yet you still work with him. And because you guys kept that relationship up, now you're producing for the Shady label, and Eminem is kind of forced to take notice. and you get to produce for a different class of artists. So that's very smart.
Hell yeah, man. Like, so my story with Wolf is goes back even further before those EPs. I met Yelawolf in New York back in 2001-ish. And I was up in New York just trying to get on as a producer, and he was up there trying to get on as an artist. And his manager just so happened to bring him to this production house that I was working in. And, you know, we were in New York. So all of those guys, if you can imagine New York in 2000, that was the heyday of, like, you know, the DMXs and all the shit that was going on. It was crazy, like a real New York thing. And we were the only two guys up there in the building that were from the South. So we just kind of met in the lobby one day, man, and spoke to each other, and we could hear the dialect in our, you know, country dialect. And we just kicked it, man, became really good friends. And for, like, you know, a couple years, 2 or 3 years after that, he would come down to South Carolina when I went back, and he went back to Alabama. We made a bunch of music, man. We really just became really tight friends. And then I moved to Atlanta before he did. He came down, man, and we just kind of got it popping, man. And from there, all those other relationships just started to flourish. And next thing you know, man, all kinds of music came out.
Yeah, the move to Atlanta was, like you said, if I'm following this timeline, early 2000s. But you're producing music in the late 90s. 5 years later, you're the founder of a label and a production studio. How'd you do that so quick?
Before I realized that I was an entrepreneur, I just had the spirit in me, man. Like, I always wanted to have my own spot. You know, back in 2002, I moved back to South Carolina and started my own production company. Essentially, I had they used to have these things. U-Haul used to have these office spaces they used to rent to people. So you could get an office space. They were like 10 by 10 rooms. I ended up renting one of those and putting my studio in it, man, and just started to run a business. I was producing for everybody local. I was the first guy to set up a, you know, sort of a home studio type of energy, because back then it was still major studios were the only things that people respected. You know what I mean? Nobody was really cutting records on computers at the time. But I saw an opportunity, man, to get the work and get it at a fraction of the cost that they were charging to go to the major studios in our town. And bro, my first year in business, man, you know, if you can imagine, you know, being young at this time, but I'll never forget it from the taxes, man. I made $88,000, man, my first year in business and out of that storage unit. And that was what kind of, you know, kicked in the whole, I can do this, you know, the entrepreneurial spirit, all that good stuff. You know what I mean?
That's amazing. $88,000 is a lot of money today. So that, yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah, it is. It is. Yeah, most definitely. And, you know, and that was the thing, man. I mean, just imagine, you know, me going to New York, trying to get on, and I did my thing, but I didn't really succeed at it like I thought I would. And, you know, imagine me coming home thinking it's all over, man. I ain't going to be, you know, whatever I was thinking. But that's when I really got a grasp of, this is really a business. This isn't really about being a major anything. Like, if you make it to that status, then fine. But, like, you could really become a wealthy person by just, you know, sticking to the basics of business and just applying it to what you love, which for me is music. You know what I mean? So once I learned that people would pay me $300 and $500 for a beat back in 2002, you know, that was, the sky was the limit then, because it was like, bro, there's a new artist every day. There's a new, someone new discovering that they want to rap, sing, write, produce, whatever, every single day. So there's just an endless amount of opportunity for you if you just decide that that's what you want to do and go for that.
Yeah. And I remember, you know, a couple of years after that evolution, Trunk Music. I live in the South. So I remember how monster of a record that was, especially when Bun B jumped on there in 2010.
Come on.
The Source magazine gave Trilogy a 5 mic rating. And I get Trilogy and I turn to the back of the CD and there's Drake on there. And being from Texas, it's like, you don't get Tupac and Slim Thug on the same damn record. And Drake, yeah. And I just remember thinking, yeah, man, finally the world is now more exposed to Texas rap, man. I was celebrating. And I remember Bun B, yeah, on Trunk Music, and that was my introduction. And I was like, man, this is a hard, this tape, yeah, it's a win.
It's crazy. That tape, man, changed my life. Period. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't even know what we did. What boy you wanna do is shit, let's get to it. You already know I'ma run right through it. I'm just like fluid, matter of fact, like water. Come on, be realer, go a little harder. Hide your girlfriend, wife, or daughter. Put it on a plane, I'ma serve your order. Line them up, put them in place for the slaughter. Game over by the end of first quarter. Wake up, hate up, rise and shine. I'ma start while you're riding pine. I got your main girl riding mine. I'm facing my lap as I recline. It's grinding time and I declare. I've run my fingers through a hair. It happened during a time when I was sort of on, like, shooting bad, you know what I mean? Like, Yella wasn't doing good either. We had just lost our deal with Columbia maybe a year or two before that. We lost the deal at Columbia like 08, 09. I'll never forget it, man. It was Halloween 2009 was when he stopped by my house and was like, October 2009. Let's go do this mixtape, man, this rap tape, bro. Like, because at the time he was trying to dabble in what he does now, which is more rock infused and country infused stuff, but hip hop cats in Atlanta wasn't feeling that shit. So he's like, bro, I'm gonna go do this rap record. Come with me, let's go do this rap record. And I was like, all right, fuck it. Drove down to Alabama from my house in Atlanta, took my whole studio. I mean, I packed up my little board and I packed up everything and went down there, and he and I locked in his house, man, and we did trunk music, man, in like, you know, a week or two, maybe 2 weeks. And I'll never forget it, man, when we did the song Pop the Trunk, bro, I rode around in his neighborhood for probably 2 hours, just circling the block, playing the fuck out of that record. Like, oh my God, this record is insane. And turns out that's the same record that changed our lives, man.
And that story brings a grin to my face from ear to ear, which must be frustrating, because once you get put on commercially, Radioactive doesn't do well because, oh, Carrie Underwood's not on there. Pink's not on the hook.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's the reason why. And that has to be frustrating as much for you as it is for him.
Yeah, it totally was. I mean, he trusted us as a label. He trusted the label to make label decisions. You know, this is a new kid, just got on. We did it on our own. The way we got there on our own, the way we liked it. And obviously we had the proper taste for it. But then we get to the label and then it's big time now. So it's like, hey, man, there's hundreds of thousands of dollars involved. There's, you know, all the big producers who were like sleeping on us before it happened are now in the mix and stuff like that. So it was just, you know, it was one of those things. But and the guys that we did the album with, these dudes were dope. Like, we had a great time making the album. And, you know, Pooh Bear is fucking amazing. All those people are dope. But the issue with the project was exactly that. You know, these songs were, you know, we would write these songs with certain people in mind. Like the Greatest Love song. That shit was supposed to have fucking Usher on it, bro. And it never happened. And so if you can imagine, like, if you could plug and play and say, hey, man, this shit would be crazy if Usher was on this record, Yella would most likely have made it to super, super started if that project would have been done, you know, the way it was mapped out.
So that makes sense. But when you started Love Story, it was a chance to correct those things. But Yelawolf was like, nah, don't send me no pre-written hooks. Don't send me no artists. Yeah. Don't send me no features. Yeah. So it's almost like, you know, the record label, or he could have said, hey, you know, I want more commercial success. Adam Levine goes here. T-Pain goes on this hook. Yeah. Nelly Furtado is going to go there. But
he had a bad taste in his mouth over the Radioactive album, which is why we went and did Love Story the same way we did Trunk Music. It was like nobody's allowed. It was just Yella and I doing the album outside of, you know, the musicians and the people we brought in to help us with our vision. But at the end of the day, bro, that was it. That's the reason why Love Story is, in my opinion, between Love Story and the first Trunk Music, like those are fucking, that's the fucking opus, man. You know what I mean? For him, it's, you know, and I know his career is still going, so he may do more and maybe even do greater things. But like those two records are those two albums are definitely what defines him. Big truck, slow ride.
matters, whatever the best is to you. Man, I just wanna give you a message. I used to sit on sidewalks like every day, watching punks and chumps and dunks get hella paid. But I just focused on my vision and never quit. And now, man, I'm sitting in my vision with a reason to celebrate. I'm in my Chevrolet.
You know, you got fans who are going to be like, hey, man, Trump music till I die. You know what I mean? And then you have people who are going to be like, man, Love Story is the greatest fucking shit I've ever heard.
I want my listeners like, why are we focused so much on the Yelawolf era? I just think it's exceptional that with just one Wiz Khalifa placement, you're now a staple at Shady. And to do all these moves, and we've talked about the uphill battle that Yella has had to climb to make a name for himself and get those Billboard placements. Now you have to work with other people, and you've tried and tried again with artists to recreate that level of success. You've worked with artists with half his problems, and that was enough for them to give up. So I find it insane that a person can hustle their craft enough to get to the point where they can be in a studio with you,
yes,
and then get in their own head and quit because they aren't patient enough to wait that 2 or 3 years it takes for you to mold them and develop their sound. I think it's sabotage in the worst way.
Yeah, bro. I mean, I'm actually fucking amazed that you have this much information, but like, you pretty much know how this is going. Like, it's tough, man. You know, it takes a certain mental place to be able to really try to take on becoming a international star of any sort. And that goes for being an athlete, that goes for being a fucking scientist. I don't give a fuck what you're doing. If you're really trying to be great, like, that's a mental space that only a few people can really get in, you know? And I learned that. Like, I used to think, yo, you know, we could do this with anybody. You know, you remember the whole Jay-Z line, you know, oh, you want to replace me? We'll make another Jay, whatever that line was. I can't remember, but that's a real fucking thing, bro. Like, it takes a special person to be able to do certain things. And what I will give to Yella and some of the guys that I've worked with, man, like, they're really different, bro. They understand what it means to wake up thinking this shit all day, man, and going to sleep and this is what it is, and writing shit on the wall and like really putting it down, man. That's what it takes to be great, man. And I'm excited. I've had a couple artists, man, that I really believed in during the past, you know, in my past, man, that I still think are dope. But when it came down to it, man, it was like, nah, you know what? I don't know that that's really what they wanted to do. You know what I mean?
Specifically, I remember Murda Stallone was signed by you, and you co-signed him as being the next top music producer. I go to his Twitter now, and he's walling out about how Lyft kidnapped his mom, and now he's a tattooer. So maybe he didn't eat, breathe this music thing or dedicate the 10,000 hours it took.
Like, life just kind of deals with you the way it does. And I'm a lifer when it comes to music. Like, I can, and I'm learning to see lifers when I see them. You know, I know what to look for now. Not a lot of people are going to go and do that. You know what I mean? And I still, to this day, stand by some of the people I co-signed, I felt like were incredible. And if you look at their work during that era that I was with them, you'll see why I believed in them. But yeah, man, I could list 10 people right now that I was just for sure were capable of being 10 times what I had already seen before. But they didn't believe that they could be 10 times what I saw. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I don't think people talk about, maybe you're talented, but you could be afraid of success. Not everyone's destined for greatness. Maybe all you got in you is a hit. Maybe you're a one-hit wonder. How did you calibrate your mind? Like, once the phone rings and they say, hey, Willpower, we saw how your last song performed. We need another one by Friday. Click. You know, how did you start dealing with that?
As long as you just keep doing what you do and do it at the highest level that you can, you really can't lose. You know what I mean? Like, they're always going to want you to recreate, you know, but stick to the script, man, if you have a script, you know. And that's the hardest part for me. I feel like people don't really think about what it is they're trying to do. And most of them don't set a destination. I won't say that success is, people are afraid of success. I think what people don't have is a true idea of what success is to even themselves. Because, you know, some artists, man, really just want to be known. They haven't thought about the financial success. They haven't thought about the their ability to become like philanthropic if they wanted to. They don't think about none of that shit. They just think, oh, shit, nobody knew me last year. Now everybody knows me this year. To them, that's success. You know what I mean? I literally watched an artist go from a couple hundred followers to 8,000 and swore that, you know, the whole world knew about him. And I was just like, ah, this is some bullshit. I don't know what to say to that. But that measure of success was true to them. But, you know, I couldn't explain to him, like, bro, 8,000 people, that's a lot of people, but it's not enough. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, if you put 8,000 people in the yard, then yeah, that's incredible. You know what I mean? But like, fuck, if you're looking at it from, if you take 8,000 people down to the stadium, then it's like, it looks like a fucking ghost town. You know what I mean?
And then obviously your definition of success has to evolve with where you are in life and in your career. Absolutely. As well.
Absolutely. I will say this. I've been way more careful in my last years of producing and the ventures that I'm taking. I've been a lot more careful about who I invest in and what I believe in, because I test them now. You know, like, I put people through fucking year of fucking artist development before I even start tweeting about their asses. You know what I mean?
I love that.
It's just real. Like, I'm not going to tell too many people about anything that I'm doing new until they've proven to me that, like, hey, man, I'm at least down to give you, to earn, you know, the conversation.
Yeah. And I know, as someone who signs talent, you don't get into that tug of war between the old guys and the young up and comers, but you have this amazing production compound, and these young guys are doing whole songs on their phones now. So as someone who has this studio, do you agree that you can craft a quality song with just an app and a phone?
Yeah. Fuck yeah. If you're really good at it. Yeah. I mean, I only have a slight issue with the people who, like, are just bullshitting and getting lucky. Like, it's sort of like day trading versus actual trading. You know what I mean? It's like, I get it. And yes, you could come in and hit a lick and get rich and become famous. But, like, I still am a purist for the art form. So I always appreciate a person who not only just makes beats, but can also play piano a little bit, or can write a song, or can, you know, is really interested in the structure of a record and cares about the song. I try not to think that that's an old school thing, because I hate the old school, new school conversation. However, I just respect what we worked for. You know what I mean? And it's still important to me. But at the same time, man, if a kid came in here, man, and was killing it on his phone, and I just knew it, I would cultivate it. I would do everything I could to help them, you know, maximize that talent. Because I do believe, man, like, the technology is just, it's inevitably going to make it easier for us. The question is, though, who's serious about it?
Yeah, I still appreciate the little details. You know, you think Love Story was a top five Billboard album because it was recorded in Blackbird Studio using a 40-year-old microphone? Probably not. But it's the little details that I still love, you know?
I think it's absolutely why it was that. I really do, man. I think that those things, man, matter to us. And that's the reason why. You know, now, it might not matter to someone who could give a fuck less about that shit. But for me, you know, it was like, oh, my God, I get to cut a record on the same piano that such and such played on, or I'm in the same room. You know, it's just a thing, bro. Some artists need to smoke a joint, man, to get creative. For me, I just need to be inspired. And that's what I think helped us make a great album. It was being inspired every day, man. So I don't know that we would have got Love Story out of just a basic studio. You know what I mean? Or I don't think we would have got Trunk Music if it wasn't in the spare room of his house with barely any lights and shit. You know what I mean?
I agree. I think if Michael Jackson and Quincy Jones were emailing beats to each other, the music would have came out differently.
It would have been way different. Exactly, man. So they were able to get in a space and get inspired. Like, that's what that is, man. And, you know, when I went to work with Eminem and, you know, in Detroit, bro, like, if you can just imagine, like, that's fucking that shit is fucking crazy. You know what I mean? Like, it's just the way life is, man. You get inspired by what you're inspired by.
I think another great example is John Coltrane recorded A Love Supreme in that L-shaped studio in Inglewood, New Jersey. You know, it has 40-foot ceilings. You know, I think if that place didn't burn down and it was, you know, what is it, the Sugar Hill Studio?
Yeah, bro. How the fuck did you know about that, man? Oh my God, bro.
Let's get it out in the open. You know, forget the Bronx, forget Brooklyn, forget Harlem. For all intents and purposes, rap started in Jersey at that studio.
Man, come on, man. Like, that place was amazing. And my career, I would, you know, give huge, huge props to that being where I started as a producer. Real echo chambers and shit like that, man. It's crazy, man. This shit is insane.
Yeah, my point was, is like, you know, they didn't construct that with 20-foot ceilings or 30. Yeah. It was purposefully 40-foot. Like, there was meticulous creations of studios back then that I still appreciate.
That's insane, bro. Yep.
you said recently labels sign a lot of bullshit. Short and sweet. What do you mean by that?
Like, I think that people, they don't give a fuck anymore, man. It's all about micro systems, man, where it's like, you know, a good single, you know, followers, all this other shit that just doesn't matter, man. I think I'm working with my artist Josh, and you know, we're always having the conversation of if what we're doing is worth it, and you know, what's gonna happen. And I'm just always like, bro, don't worry about that, you know, like, keep working, because the labels aren't the end all anymore. Deals are different now. Like, deals can happen with shit, you could go pull up on Sprite, man, and they'll cut you a check the size of what your deal would be if, you know, if you're smart about your business. Like, here's the part of this whole shit that's weird to me sometimes. So everybody thinks this record label shit is like this genius map. I think it's overstated. They really just market well, man. They have a system that's been in place for thousands of years, maybe not thousands, but hundreds of years for sure. And I think that what people forget is the checks are not what they think they are. It's like, let's say you could even catch $600,000 for your deal. That's not bad, but like, that $600,000 is like accounted to different things like marketing and recording and, you know, your advance, all these different things. And then it's also taxed money. So it's like, all right, cool, man. You got a little lick. But I believe in today's times, it's like, yo, you could really get $600,000 from a good sponsor, a person who doesn't want your damn masters, doesn't want to be in your pockets the rest of your life. They just want you to help them move product. You know what I mean? Like, there's this whole new line of clothes coming out, or these new shoes, or this new drink that everybody's going to want, or this alcohol, or... And I think people are getting lost in that. So I think the label business is just like, dude, don't stress that. Like, who are they? You know, the people know what they like. And with playlisting, it's like, bro, there ain't even no such thing as a genre anymore to me. I think people are just making music and it's whatever.
But it's harder to find success in R&B than it was back in the day. I mean, if we are putting genre listings on things.
Yeah. Of course it is. I mean, and that's just because people aren't as sappy as they used to be. Nobody's like, men aren't really loving on women like that no more, and women, and yeah, it just ain't the same. There's a whole new narrative. But R&B to me doesn't mean that the music has to be about those things. Like, it's really just melody, man. It's like making really intentional melody and having it resonate. If we're just completely honest, R&B just means, to me, it just means black people singing. You know, I mean, let's just keep it real, because what's the difference? What's the difference between pop music? It's the same shit, except in most cases, it's white people singing. So it still exists, man. It's just, when you give it a title, that's when you end up getting marketed a certain way. You know what I mean? It's like, what's the difference between gospel music and praise and worship? Like, to me, it's just black and white. It's like, white people call it praise and worship. Black people call it gospel music. but it's still the same music. It's all about God. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's just a section in the record store. I get it.
Exactly. That's it. And like record stores are gone now. And now I'm glad you said that, because record stores are gone. So what's the point? We're in a genreless community now. I feel like if you just learn how to make dope ass, if you're a singer, learn how to make the music that resonates with everyone right now. And that will just make you the different person, because everybody else is rapping right now or sing rapping right now, whatever the hell you want to call it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Nobody's like definitive. It's like, I do both. I don't want to hear both right now. I want to hear somebody do this shit and do it well. Or I don't want to hear you singing. I want to hear you rapping.
Yeah. It's that, like, makes a lot of sense. Yeah. And I was trying to figure out, like, how, you know, you take an artist like Adrian Marcel, platinum selling, co-signed by you, mentored by Raphael Sadiq, but he didn't blow up as much as a Frank Ocean, who hasn't released an album in 5 years, yet people still talk about him and clamor for another album. And I just don't understand how in this streaming forgetful culture, there are those few outliers that after 1500 days, people still remember you as strong as they did when you initially dropped an album. Like, you couldn't write a book on that, because there's no formula. There's no rhyme or reason. Fans love consistent delivery on music.
They love consistency, but they also love when a motherfucker's brave enough to be different. Like, that's what people relate to, bro. They don't give a fuck about you coming in and sounding just like anybody. Nobody cares about that. What made Frank Ocean different, number one, was he hung out with the fucking wildest goddamn rappers in the game at the time. He was a part of, like, the wildest crew at the time. So anybody affiliated with them motherfuckers was considered cool. You know what I mean? And then on top of that, you know, he had this amazing announcement that he decided to make right at the time that he dropped his album, which made him even more brave and more different. You know what I'm saying? Like, and all of a sudden now it's the greatest fucking shit ever. And, you know, the album was incredible. Of course it was. But there were just so many things that made it what it was, bro. And that's what I think artists are forgetting. It's like, bro, Andre 3000 will never not be considered one of the greatest, because he managed to be that different. And we both know that Big Boy is just as dope, if not doper, a rapper. Like, they got bars, bro. Like, it's incredible. But I think what people are losing in this whole system is just the artistry of it is being lost. Like, why aren't people being creative anymore? Like, that's what makes it. That's what made Frank Ocean's album better than everyone else's that year that was doing R&B.
Never thought of it like that, man. That's actually kind of incredible, because you're looking at it from a culture perspective.
It's cool. And that's the part that, now that's what I had to learn. But I learned it not because I even thought about it, bro. I wasn't studying it. I just had to come to terms with it. And, you know, not to bring up Yella again, man, but Yella at the time was culturally important, bro. He was different. It was wild. It was fresh. It was something else. It went crazy, man. Period. Him and Tyler the Creator, like, them motherfuckers are the reason why the needles move. You know what I mean? And every now and then, and so I'll say even more often now than before, you get people like that. That's where your Trippy Reds come in, and people that just don't give a fuck. They just like being fucking weird and own that shit. And they own it.
Implanting diamonds in their forehead and shit.
Oh, man. Wilding out. Now that type of shit, in my opinion, is sort of, that's clout. There's a difference between clout chasing, though.
And it's a fine line.
I will say that. But I think when an artist is authentic to themselves and understand what it means to be authentic, that's when you find those, you know, diamonds in the rough.
Well, you said 2020 changed you. No more handouts, hookups, barters, no more free game.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Absolutely, man. Like, I've been a giver all my career, and I will continue to give, but I'm also going to require, you know, I require from people now, man, something in return. And that's not necessarily a physical thing. What I want is, you know, I just want some heart, man, some heart in it, some desire, some grunt. You know what I mean? Because, like, I spend a lot of time teaching and opening my doors up to people. You'd be surprised how many hundreds of people have been in my facility. I've only been open now maybe 4 years. But, man, all kinds of people come in here and they get shit and we give and we, you know, we're coaching and teaching and learning. And, you know, at the end of the day, man, you know, I'm not – it's tough when people don't know what to do with it. So I'm just getting back in the space of making people go through what I went through. Like, you got to earn it, bro. Like, I'm not going to just give it away anymore. You know what I mean?
There's negative connotations around the word selfish, but I feel like sometimes you got to be selfish. It's a good thing.
I love that word. It's important. You have to be selfish, man, because if you don't, you know what I mean? You will get taken advantage of. Like, I'll say this. I have a fine line in my career. So to people who like what I do and are, like, you know, supporters and fans of my work, it looks good. But, man, like, I lost a lot during the process. You know, even down with my situation with the artists I've worked with, man, like, I didn't always win, bro. Like, you know, my all that time I worked with Wolf, man, that wasn't all great, man. Like, that shit was fucking stressful, bro. You know what I mean? Like, this is a great friend of mine, man, that I grew up with practically in music, man. But, like, bro, we hardly talk. We don't even really have that much of a relationship anymore because the music industry and all of the politics that comes with it, bro, like, it makes it tough to be friends, you know, afterwards, because it's like, what the fuck, man? You know, like, there's things that I felt I deserved and there's things that he felt he deserved. I mean, it just does it to you. So you learn, man, that, like, somewhere down that line, bro, you have to become more selfish, you know, because selfless, you know, has its place, but, like, at some point you have to stand up for yourself and just be like, you know what, that's it. I'm not doing that anymore.
You take someone like Trinidad James or Crit or Bubba Sparks or Dizzy Wright, and let's just say they release 5 albums and they don't call you up. It's hard not to take things like that personally, but
absolutely. Happens every day, bro. Happens every day, bro. I've had people that I helped make millions of dollars with, man, musically, that when they move on to their next gig, you know, it's like, I gotta, like, fucking dangle carrots and shit and offer free studio time. I gotta do all kinds of shit just to get noticed. And it's like, that's some bullshit. You know what I mean? But you also learn over, like, for me, I've learned to never take it personal, man. Like, it's not that deep. Like, you just gotta keep pushing, you know what I mean? And keep working through it and don't burn the bridge. You know what I mean? Like, it's been times, bro, where my anger, I was so mad about it that, you know, I could literally fuck the play up for myself. But I learned early in the game that don't ever let your anger put you in a position to where you can't keep working. Cause I've done that before, you know, snapped off in the room and just be like, man, fuck this. Ah. You know, and next thing you know, like, that person just, like, kind of told 50 people and now you can't go in 50 rooms as opposed to one. So you learn over the years, but with that, you still have to stand your ground. But the music business is like high school, man. Once you're in it, you know what I mean? It's real tough to stay cool, man. I just found myself having to harden up, you know, for certain things because you start to recognize a pattern in the types of people who will not be there for you when you need them. You can act like you don't know what that shit looks like, but you know, and you can only blame yourself when it continues to happen to you. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Because it's like, yeah, you can't look the other way when your gut is saying, nah, bro, that ain't it. You got to, like, challenge that. You got to say something, you know, put the elephant in the room and, like, get the room open. Let's go. What are we talking about? And that way you could be clear up front. Imagine in situations where you're working and, you know, you work, this is what you do, you know, so whatever monies you make producing music, you know, that's your livelihood. But imagine doing music with people that you're cool with, and you fuck with them really heavy, man, and you put a lot of time into it. And then when it comes time to actually get down to the business, like, you're expected to not do business. You're expected to be a friend at that point. You know, and it's like, that's when it gets weird. It's like, what? Wait. So I got time. I came here and I contributed and I've done everything I can and can't do. You know what I mean? And then it comes down to time to pay me And now I'm expected to either take a L on this or cut my prices down, whatever the fuck people want you to do. You got to be able to say, you got to know that that's not right. And you got to be okay with the fact that, like, it might fuck the play up later if you stand on yours, but principle is everything.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, man. And I want to do right by you. I want to give you this time to plug anything, projects, where people can find you, because I just want to see, you know, W's for you. I enjoy learning about your story, and, you know, I just want to see continued success.
Yeah, well, thank you for having me on the show first, man. And I hope this show does really well. I'm on all social networks as Willpower, WLPWR. My label and studio name in Atlanta is Bandwidth. It's spelled BNDWTH, and that's on all social media. And, you know, bro, I'm out here, man. So thank you.
Yeah, what was it like being on the other side of the podcast table? I hope I did okay.
Oh, you killed it, man. This is a dope. It's dope, man. I mean, you managed to open up some doors, man, on this conversation I probably wouldn't normally talk about, but I appreciate it. It's all good.
Awesome, man. Yeah, I appreciate you swinging through, man. Thanks for your time.